Back in 1973, Marvin Miller and the Players Association had maneuvered the owners into agreeing to impartial binding arbitration of salary disputes. Now, in 1975, after 10 years of battling with the owners, Miller was ready to take on the reserve clause.
From the beginning, I had felt that the contract which the owners had drawn up with the players simply gave the owners the right to extend a contract for one additional year when the player and owner could not agree on a new contract. The owners had interpreted this to mean an extension right that went for the life of the player. And I could not read that into that contract. So what we needed, obviously, were two things. First, we needed a grievance and arbitration procedure under which differences in interpretation would go before somebody impartial and not the owner's commissioner. Secondly, we needed a test case. Mrs. Smith and McNally provided that.
In 1975, two first-rate pitchers, Dave McNally of the Montreal Expos and Andy Messersmith of the Los Angeles Dodgers, agreed to play 1 year without contracts, declared themselves free agents, then filed for a hearing before a new three-man arbitration panel. Marvin Miller voted for the players. John Guerin, representing Major League Baseball, voted against them. The third man was a professional arbitrator named Peter Seitz. He was convinced the players were right and begged the owners to come up with a new and equitable contract. They refused. On December 23, 1975, Seitz voted with the players. The owners were too stubborn and stupid, he said. They were like the French barons of the 12th century. They had accumulated so much power, they wouldn't share it with anybody. The owners, claiming this would bankrupt baseball, fired Seitz the next day and went to court to have the decision overturned. This time, they failed. The arbitration was binding. The reserve clause was dead.
When the arbitrator finally agreed with the union that an owner could only control a player for 1 year, the time had come to negotiate a whole new system, and the owners panicked. They could not picture living under a system in which every player would be a free agent every year.
Miller shrewdly offered the owners what seemed on the surface a compromise. Players would not be eligible for free agency until they had played 6 years. The owners gratefully agreed. At least they could still control their most valuable assets for a time. But baseball would never be the same again. The law of supply and demand now favored the players.
And even though the arbitrator's decision gave the players the right to be free agents every year, we felt that it was in the interest of the game and the players that that supply of free agents not be so great every year and that there be an eligibility requirement.